All right, guys, how's it going? I'm pretty sure that we're all aware by now that Polaris is going to be launching by the end of this month. So this will be my final analysis video on Polaris without having any of the cards. Now, one or two of you have mentioned that I should probably point out that this is speculation. All this stuff up till now is basically speculation. But for me, it's not really speculation. And this video will be explaining why. It's really all about simple maths and knowing graphics card history. It's that combination that allows me to be so close with my predictions. I'm just going to lay it all out in this video. Right, so the first place I'm going to start with is specs. We've known for a while that Polaris 10 had one version with 36 CUs, or compute units, capable of more than 5 teraflops. That alone gives us a minimum clock speed of the card, and we also know the memory size of 256 bits. There's some semi-new information on Polaris 11 as well. We can see that it's a much smaller chip, around about half the size, capable of greater than 2 teraflops, and with a 128-bit bus. So no great surprises here. This older slide, which I have used quite a lot in the past, shows us that the memory size will be 4 or 8 gigabytes of GDDR5, and it also gives us a memory bandwidth of 256 gigabytes per second. That memory bandwidth number, combined with the memory bitrate, lets us know that it is using 8 gigabits per second memory, which is the fastest GDDR5 memory available. And we also have a number of 150 watts of power. So here are all the RX480's important specs. You've got the number of compute units, which is 36. You can easily get the number of stream processors from that. Stream processors can be called SPs or shaders or even cores. Simply put, you multiply that 36 compute units by 64 and you get 2,304 stream processors. Below that, we can see the boost clock of 1,266. Where did I get that from? There have been leaks about this boost clock for the past 2 months, and they all point to a 1,266 MHz boost clock. Here's one here from Computex, I believe. 1,266 MHz is pretty likely to be the reference card's boost clock. And by using 2,304 stream processors, multiply that number by 2 for 4,608, and then multiply by the boost clock in gigahertz, which is 1.266, gives you the 5.8 teraflops number. Stuff like texture units and ROPs, we don't know about these. The texture units will definitely be right. ROPs, I am not sure about. It could possibly be 32. In all honesty, these numbers don't mean an awful lot these days. Texture units and ROPs are what used to bottleneck graphics cards a very long time ago. The RX 480 will basically have a choice of 32 or 64 ROPs. I'm pretty sure it'll be 64 though, because they are selling it as a VR capable card. ROPs are mostly useful for higher resolutions, so if AMD have only given it 32 ROPs and then attempt to sell it as a VR premium card, well, let's just say AMD does a lot of silly things, but this would be one of the most stupid yet. I'm pretty sure these numbers will be correct, but they are not that important. So that is all the specs there that really matters. Most of these numbers only really matter when comparing against other AMD graphics cards. And when we're trying to figure out the likely performance range of the RX 480, the best way to do it is against other AMD cards, in and around this 5.8 teraflops level. So let's take a look at some other AMD cards around about this 5.8 teraflops level, and then I'm going to have a look at how architectural changes can make the RX 480 either slower or faster than some of these cards. So I'm going to start with the R9380X, mostly because it's got a pretty similar number of compute units and stream processors, 32 on the 380X versus 36 on the 480. As you already know, by multiplying that number by 64, you get the number of stream processors. If we just skip the boost clock right now, we can see the teraflops of only 4 teraflops for the 380X is quite a bit below the 5.8 of the RX 480, and that is simply because of the clock speeds. 1266 MHz divided by 970 MHz gives you a 31% higher clock speed. So if the R9380X had the same clock speed of 1266 MHz, it would have around about 5.2 teraflops. So obviously clock speed is pretty important, and a clock speed increase is a pretty natural occurrence whenever a new node arrives. The R9380X is of course based on 28 nanometer technology, whereas the RX 480 is based on 14 nanometer FinFET technology. This is what has allowed AMD to increase the clock speeds by over 30% here. And basically speaking, it is almost like free performance. Again, the textured units and ROPs, you can see that with 144 versus 128 textured units, that is not a huge gap because those are tied to the number of compute units. And looking at the ROPs, the R9380X only has 32. Now remember, this is speculation on the RX 480's ROPs. It may only have 32, but I believe it will be 64. If we now compare the memory, we can see that the memory bandwidth of the RX 480 is quite a bit higher, and this is simply because it has got faster memory on the same 256-bit memory bus. And down the bottom, we can see the R9380X draws more power. So that's the R9380X. If you just look at those specs, the RX 480 should be clearly faster. On these specs alone, you would expect over 40% faster performance from the RX 480 compared to the R9380X. Right, so now I have added the R9390X. With 44 compute units, it is quite a bit ahead of the other two. And of course, with the increase in compute units comes a corresponding increase in stream processors, up to 2816. Because it's a 28 nanometer GPU, however, the clock speeds are a good deal lower than the RX 480s, the combination of which means that the R9390X is just ahead in teraflops compared to the RX 480. Once again, because your texture units are tied to your compute units, we have a higher number, and the R9390X does have 64 ROPs. Again, please remember that I am guessing that the RX 480 has 64 here. So the R9390X is a little bit ahead there, which we can see simply by comparing the teraflops. When we look at the memory, however, the gap seems to increase by quite a lot. Even though it's got slower memory, that is 6 gigabits per second against the 8 gigabits on the RX 480, it has double the memory bus width, 512 bits compared to 256 bits. This means that overall, the memory bandwidth, which with memory is the important number really, 384 gigabytes per second compared to only 256 of the RX 480. That is a big gap. And right down the bottom, we can see that it is a much more power hungry card, 275 watts compared to 150. If you just look at the specs overall, there doesn't seem to be any real chance of the RX 480 beating the R9390X, especially with the gap in memory bandwidth. But in order to see if that's really the case, then let's take a closer look at the GPU itself and some of the changes in Polaris to see if Polaris can overcome these deficits or not. So here's a block diagram of the R9380X. All those CUs we talked about, we have 8 CUs per shader engine. So if you just count those up, 8 times 4, 32. This RB here is your render backends, each of which has 4 ROPs, and 8 times 4 is 32. So 32 CUs and 32 ROPs, which is exactly what the chart shows, 32 compute units, 32 ROPs. Now this is a block diagram of the 390X. Straight away we can see that the ROPs have doubled, which means 64, and instead of 8 compute units per shader engine, we can see there is 11. 11 compute units, 4 shader engines, and there's your 44 compute units. And again, your 64 ROPs. So if the RX 480 has only 32 ROPs, it will look very much like this. The only real difference being an extra compute unit per shader engine with, in my opinion, double the ROPs. But if we go back to the RX 480 versus the R9390X, how can it beat the R9390X when it loses in specs, especially on that memory front? Well, let's deal with the memory side of things first of all. In this benchmark here, over at the Tech Report, using Beyond3D's bandwidth benchmarking test, we can see here the difference between black textures and random textures regarding bandwidth. What this actually shows us is how well memory compression works on each of these cards. So the solid bars here show the amount of bandwidth in gigabytes per second that each card is using while drawing a completely black texture on the screen. When you run a random texture through the same benchmark, in some cases we can clearly see the difference. It's interesting to see just how much better Maxwell is compared to the rest. That is your GTX 980, 980 Ti and Titan X. The memory compression on these cards is much better than what it is on, for example, the GTX 780 Ti and even the Fury X. But what's interesting here is that the Radeon R9290X, which as you probably know is the same silicon, basically the same card as the 390X, it is showing no difference whatsoever between the black texture and the random texture. And the reason for that is simply, the R9290X and the R9390X do not have any kind of memory compression technologies whatsoever. You may also notice that the R9290X is not capable of reaching its maximum memory bandwidth. In this case, that would be 320 gigabytes per second. So it is falling short of the capability of saturating all of its memory bandwidth and they don't even have any memory compression at all. The reason for which is the 290X, the 390X, are based on slightly older graphics core next revisions. AMD did add some pretty good compression later on. It was initially added to their Tonga class of GPUs, that is their R9285, which became the R9380 and the R9380X. And here we can see the difference between the R9285 and the R9280. Even though the R9280 had a bigger memory bus, it did not stop the R9285 beating it quite easily. But there's more to it than just that. If we look at this old slide of the Polaris architecture, we can see all the stuff that is new. What is interesting here, in terms of bandwidth, could be the new L2 cache. The L2 cache is basically just memory on the graphics chip itself. Storing data in L2 cache is much more efficient than storing data in memory off the chip. So the stuff that is used most often gets stored in L2, and rather than having to make a trip out to the memory on the graphics card, which requires more bandwidth, a much more efficient way of getting performance out of a new graphics chip is by improving the L2 cache. There are a couple of ways to do this. It will improve naturally with higher clock speeds, which are of course a result of the new process. There are other ways to do it as well though. For example, in the case of the 380X here, and even in the case of the 390X, these cards had 1 MB of L2 cache. So it is possible that with the new node, the RX 480 may have a larger, faster L2 cache. These are just things that we expect to come from a new process. But the important thing here is, all these numbers, the 384 GB/s of memory bandwidth, it's not the be and end all. Even with only half of the memory bus width, I would expect the RX 480, due to having advanced memory compression, and due to having faster, and possibly even larger level 2 cache, I would expect the RX 480 to have a faster, more efficient memory subsystem than the R9390X. So now we've got two graphics cards that should be very, very close together. The only real difference being this 0.1 teraflop, but that still means the RX 480 will be a little bit behind, unless it can make up the difference elsewhere. So what improvements can actually be made to make the RX 480 faster than the R9390X? Well, if we take a look at the Polaris architecture improvements again, we can see a new command processor, a new geometry processor, and new 4th generation graphics core next CUs. Now generally speaking, from architecture to architecture, these things improve. You certainly don't try to make them worse, but it's not always that simple. Now the new geometry processor, we really don't know a lot about that, but in the past we saw a slide mentioning the primitive disk card accelerator. We've got no idea what this does yet, but given the name, we can sort of figure out that the whole point of this is to get rid of unused primitives, basically so that the engines aren't wasting time drawing stuff that isn't on the screen. So that should just cause an overall improvement. And if we then look at the 4th generation graphics core next CUs, the whole point of improving these is to get more performance on a per CU basis. For want of a better term, if we just think about it as CPU, IPC, instructions per clock, all of these improvements together, even with only 36 compute units compared to the 44 of the 390X, all of those improvements should effectively lift the RX 480 up to a level which is approaching the R9390X. In simple terms, those 2304 stream processors could theoretically be working just as well as the 2816 of the R9390X. More likely though, we may be looking at say 5 to 10% increase. So let's just take 10%, which is a nice easy number. That would mean the RX 480 has the equivalent of 2534 stream processors. And if you multiply that number by 2, and then multiply that number by 1.266 again, you now have 6.4 teraflops of performance. That assumes that AMD has made a progression and not a regression. It is possible. It has been clear from the start that Polaris was designed to be a very low power architecture. So it is certainly possible that rather than increasing performance per compute unit, performance may have regressed instead. Simpler shaders to save power. So this is something that may happen, and if the card cannot match the R9390X, that is the likely reason why. There is a second reason, and that is of course drivers. New architectures take longer for drivers to mature. Similar story could happen here. Even though it's still GCN, there may be driver issues there, which prevent the RX 480 from showing its true performance from the start. I'm not sure I believe that one though, because AMD has had silicon in their hands since last November. So I don't believe that drivers are an excuse here. For me though, it's rather simple. The RX 480 should beat the R9390X. There's been a lot of rumours suggesting otherwise, but based on the raw stats, and based on the fact that AMD should be increasing IPC, I believe that is the far more likely probability here. There is, of course, one final way to improve performance. The clock speed of 1266MHz, I am quite sure, will not be near the limit of this card. AMD had a big problem on 28nm. They simply could not overclock their cards very far, and power numbers shot through the roof whenever you tried, so they were very much limited by power and the 28nm process. The 14nm FinFET process should really help a lot with clock speeds. And the most recent rumours, like over at WCCF Tech, are suggesting round about 1500 to 1600MHz. Which, if true, the RX 480 at around 1500MHz cannot be far away from Titan X performance, at least in DirectX 12 games. We shall know all about that very, very soon. Right, so that's it for this one. I just wanted to do a bit more educational video. I wanted to point out how I come to these conclusions. It's just logic, it's just numbers, it's just the history of graphics cards. All that can happen now is that we are pleasantly surprised or unpleasantly shocked. Let's hope for the former, and let's hope for a $200 graphics card, the likes of which we haven't seen in a very, very long time. That's what I am hoping for from AMD here. But like I said, that is me done with the speculation and the conjecture for Polaris. The next stuff you hear about from me is going to be factual. In the meantime though, I've got a benchmarking PC to build, so look out for that one soon, TM. I'm going to be really, really busy from now until the end of this month, but I will catch you later, guys.